Hello and welcome to Chairside Live. I'm your host, Megan Strong. Thanks so much for joining us. In today's episode, Dr. Justin Chi is removing some fractured ceramic crowns on number 14 and number 19, and he's replacing them with BruxZir NOW crowns, milled chairside. And here's one of the great bonuses of Chairside Digital Dentistry. While the crowns are milling, you can do other work on the patient, as Dr. Chi did in this case, removing decay from the mesial of number 15. Let's check it out.
We have a 50-year-old male that presents with a fractured Emax crown on his upper left first molar, number 14, that also appears to have supererupted, most likely from the low occlusal position of the crown on the lower left first molar, number 19. We plan to replace both with BruxZir NOW crowns milled chairside using the GlideWell in-office solution. The upper left second molar also has a large cavity on the mesial, so we'll work on that while the crowns are milling. Based on the pre-op radiograph, I initially thought number 19 was a porcelain fused to zirconia crown because of the radiopacity near the margins and the core. So I began the removal with a 557 carbide, as I usually do for feldspathic porcelain, but it was really difficult to cut through. Switching to a zircator diamond burr made the sectioning a bit easier. Realizing now we have a bonded ceramic restoration, I needed to make several sectional cuts through the crown to separate it off the prep. I then refined the prep with a coarse grit round-ended tapered diamond and 850-018 on the axial surfaces to create a chamfered margin that's positioned equigingivally. I like to ensure my crown preps have at least a half millimeter gingival wall that I verify using a perio probe. I trace the margins with the probe to confirm there's an apical stop and that it's smooth circumferentially. By establishing enough reduction at the margins, it creates a sharp cable surface finish line that makes it much easier to identify where the margins are. To complete the prep, I ensure the axial walls have adequate taper and the internal angles are rounded. Next, I place a size 2 cord and let that sit for a few minutes while I prep the upper molar. I make sectional cuts along the buccal, occlusal, and lingual to the depth of the prep with a zircator diamond burr. I ran into an issue here when trying to separate the crown with the Christensen crown remover. When I twisted clockwise to separate the crown, part of the lumineer on the second premolar fractures off. Next time I'm in a similar situation, I'll add a mesial to distal slot on the occlusal and try separating along that to hopefully apply less force against the adjacent teeth. The good news is that the patient wants to replace his veneers anyway for something more aesthetic, so at least we got a head start on that. Since the tooth supererupted, I reduce more on the occlusal until the prep is about 1.5 millimeters below the adjacent teeth, so the final crown can be in the proper plane of occlusion. I refine the rest of the prep following the same guidelines as before: chamfer margins, adequate taper, and rounded internal angles. I also place a size 2 cord here for gingival retraction since the margins are all equigingival. After having set for several minutes now, I remove the retraction cord from the lower molar to expose the space between the prep and tissue, which is exactly what we want for an accurate impression. Once the cord is removed, we dry the site very well and begin our digital impression with the iTero element. We first take a high-resolution image of the prep, then add in the rest of the adjacent teeth to complete the lower quadrant scan. We'll repeat the same on the upper molar with a high-res scan of the prep, followed by the rest of the quadrant. As I sweep the scanner along the occlusal, buccal, and lingual, I watch the screen as the system continuously builds the digital model, and we'll deactivate the camera once I determine enough of the quadrant is captured. It's really important to ensure the contact surfaces of the adjacent teeth are captured in these scans. The digital impression is then transferred to the Fast Design software, where we're able to custom design both opposing restorations at the same time. I build both designs to better match the occlusal planes of the surrounding dentition and can easily verify the functional positions from both the buccal and lingual views. The final check is to establish the correct proximal and occlusal contact parameters. The great thing with digital is each clinician can custom set these values to their preferred settings. After 5 minutes, when the design is complete, I'll load a BruxZir NOW block and diamond burr into the fast mill. While these crowns mill, it's a great opportunity to work on any other procedures the patient may need. In this case, I'll remove and restore the cavity on the mesial of the upper second molar. With the tooth prepped away on number 14, I have clear access to approach this class 2 lesion from the mesial. Using a round diamond, I begin the caries removal by extending towards the gingival, occlusal, buccal, and lingual until healthy, sound tooth structure surrounds the decay. I'll then use a slow-speed carbide to remove the deep caries. I place a dry 00 cord in the mesial sulcus to help displace the tissue a bit more apically. I etch the prep with Kerr's phosphoric acid for 15 seconds, rinse and dry, ensuring not to desiccate the dentin, followed by a 1 minute application of gluma desensitizer. After a minute, I'll use a surgical suction to aspirate any excess, then I'll scrub Scotchbond Universal into the prep for about 20 seconds. I incrementally restore the cavity using camouflage nanohybrid flowable composite. I use a fine grit diamond burr for the gross finishing and contouring, then polish to a smooth finish with the Venus Super Polishing Kit. We now have the lower crown finished and ready to try in once the sprue is removed. When the correct parameters are dialed in on the software, there's very little to no adjustments needed to the proximal contacts. We cement this crown in place using 3M's resin-modified glass ionomer, Reli-X Luting Plus. The excess is easily removed when it enters a gel state after 2 minutes. These restorations come right out of the mill with a very nice surface finish. For this lower crown, I polish the surface using Clinician's Choice All-Surface Access Polishing Kit. For the upper crown, I added low-fusing stain and glaze from the Obsidian CAD kit to show a comparison between the two finishing options. As expected, due to the mesial composite on number 15, some adjustments are needed on this distal contact. We mark the contact using a small strip of articulating paper so I know exactly where to reduce. Once the proximal and occlusal contacts are properly adjusted, we go ahead and cement this crown also using 3M's Reli-X Luting Plus. We were able to address the patient's concern by efficiently delivering very strong and aesthetic BruxZir NOW crowns. Each restoration took 40 minutes to mill, so when fabricating multiple BruxZir crowns chairside, that time must be taken into consideration for your scheduling. Both crowns were milled using an A1 block, but if additional characterization is desired, you can see the difference the 10-minute optional oven cycle can provide these restorations. If you'd like more information on how the system can enhance your practice, please visit glidewell.io. Thank you for tuning in for this episode of Chairside Live. Back to you, Megan.
Thank you for that, Dr. Chi. For more information on how you can seamlessly integrate digital dentistry into your practice, visit glidewell.io. Well, that about wraps it up for this episode of Chairside Live. On behalf of everyone here at Glidewell Dental, thank you for watching, and I'll meet you right back here next time.